الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم وملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولداً ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيراً والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجاً والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا ثم أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم الذين قال لهم الناس إن الناس قد جمعوا لكم فاخشوهم فزادهم إيماناً وقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل فانقلبوا بنعمة من الله وفضل لم يمسسهم سوء واتبعوا رضوان الله والله ذو فضل عظيم إنما ذلكم الشيطان يخوف أولياءه فلا تخافوهم وخافوني إن كنتم مؤمنين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر أمين يا رب العالمين. On this occasion of Friday, I feel like the Muslim community feels the need for a concession speech more than Hillary Clinton. But what I wanted to share with you this week are thoughts and some reminders and some reflection for myself. Clearly what's happened in the elections is on everybody's minds. A lot of people are very concerned, very scared, very nervous about what's happening. Many of you know that the Canadian website for immigration crashed as soon as the election polls came out. And so a lot of people are thinking about moving out of the country or whether this is our home anymore. And of course, some of the most bigoted things that we never imagined would be surfacing and becoming mainstream in this country are now becoming, you know, they're surfacing. Just recently at the airport, somebody even cracked a joke, a friend of mine, they cracked a joke, hey, go back to your country. And that was in Los Angeles. Go back to your country. And he said, that's not funny. And I said, oh, I'm just kidding, you're one of the good ones. Now that kind of thing, which was a completely unacceptable kind of comment, has now become mainstream, right? So there's reason to be concerned. But what I wanted to do is take a step back and remind ourselves that Muslims, we have been in this situation before. This is not the first time we're facing this kind of a, you know, perceived hostile situation. It's not the end of the world. As a matter of fact, in the Bush years, these kinds of concerns were also overshadowing the minds of the Muslims. And the second term of President Bush, probably similar khutbahs were being given. So I want to begin first and foremost with a reminder from the one place that gives us comfort and the one place that gives us protection. The Book of Allah isn't just a place that we find hope and guidance in, it's also our multahad. وَلَن تَجِدَ مِن دُونِهِ مُلْتَحَدًا It's the place we find refuge and the place we find protection. So when you and I are feeling that we don't have protection, we go to the Book of Allah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, about a people, this was actually revealed after the Muslims had suffered terrible losses at Uhud. They were weak, they couldn't even stand up straight, and the Prophet ﷺ said, after the enemy had left, and the Prophet himself ﷺ was almost killed. So this is a pretty bad situation for the Muslims. They were almost killed. And the kuffar have talked trash as we were heading up the mountain. You know, if تُسْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْمُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ You're climbing up the mountain, you wouldn't even turn back to look at anybody. وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ And some of the Muslims were so scared, the Sahaba so scared, they're running up and the Prophet ﷺ is still on the battlefield calling them from behind. And then they came back and they rescued him and they got him up the mountain. And then, you know, back then the leaders of the enemies of Islam, they spoke in this talking trash kind of way to the Muslims from the bottom of the mountain. You know, praising their gods, because their gods have won this time. And the Rasulullah ﷺ responded to them, they left. But about halfway through when the Quraysh had left, a thought came to the enemy. Hey man, they're weak right now and they're injured. We let them live. We should just go back and finish the job. We should just kill them all. Now is our opportunity. This is the first time we've got them down. They got us pretty bad at Badr, but now we've dealt them a pretty serious blow at Uhud. Let's go back and get them. So a thought was coming to them to turn around and finish what they started. And the intelligence report came to the Prophet ﷺ that they're coming back. And when that report came to the Prophet ﷺ, instead of saying, oh my God, we're not ready to fight them, we need to run. The Prophet ﷺ said, who's going to get up with me? Let's go. Before they come here, we should go after them. We should go after them. And these Sahaba, they actually, many of them injured, can't even get up, got up and started walking towards the enemy. And they just responded to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And others said, what are you doing? You're going to get killed. You're not equipped. Even when we were equipped, we couldn't fight them. How are you going to fight them now? And in response, Allah revealed a number of ayat. This is just a few of them. الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسِ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ. When people said to them, people, others, the enemy has gathered against you. فَخْشَوْهُمْ. You should be afraid of them. They were making sense. People have ganged up against you. They hate you. They want to kill you. I mean, this is far more extreme than what we're going through. This is just an election cycle, guys. This is the Battle of Uhud. This is far more extreme. And they have more reason to be scared than we ever will be. May Allah protect this ummah, but these people have far more reason to be terrified. They're literally bleeding. And then what do they say? They say, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. فَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. They say, Allah is enough for us. He'll be enough to take care of our situation. He'll be enough. That is the response. When you hear that response now, when you know, the Muslim's nervous, man, what's going to happen with us? I don't know. I'm afraid to even go to the grocery store. Maybe we should tell our daughters and our wives and our mothers to kind of take the hijab off, or maybe, you know, not go to Walmart. I don't recommend Walmart anyway. But, you know, don't go there because somebody might say something or do something, and just be vigilant. By the way, vigilance is important. But on a side note, our first response is supposed to be Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Allah is enough for us. He's enough to take care of our situation. This situation happened now in 2016. Who's kept the situation from happening for the last 50 years? Who's kept the Muslims? Who's kept you safe in your home and me safe in my home for all this time? Who's provided for us for all this time? You think that protection just got lifted because an election happened? That security is not there anymore? Politics will come and go. Rulers will come and go. Parties will come and go. But the protection of Allah for the believer is always there. It's always there. It doesn't go away. And you cannot let that go. And the moment you forget about Allah. The moment you think this is a bigger situation for us to handle, and you forget that you have the rope of Allah in your hands, then don't become like the people, you know, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهِ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. It's so beautiful. Allah said, don't be like people who forgot Allah, and Allah made them forget themselves. You know, the reciprocal statement should have been, don't be like the people who forget Allah, and Allah forgot about them. He didn't say that. He didn't say that, because He doesn't forget about you. Even when you forget about Him. Even when you forget about it. Even when you and I don't pray. Even when you and I sin. Even when you and I disregard His commands. He still protects you. He still takes care of you. He doesn't forget you. You forget Him, He doesn't forget you. He says, when you forget Allah, what happens then? What's the reaction to that? فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. He makes them forget who they are, themselves. The Muslims start fearing other than Allah, and then they start losing their Islam. Hijab started coming up. This is not the first time I've had this conversation. The week after 9/11, I remember giving the khutbah. Because the conversation was, we should leave this country. We should not be here anymore. They're going to kill all of us. Put us in concentration camps. Remember special registration? I went for special registration. I stood it 15, 16 hours and was spoken to like not a human being. I remember those experiences. Allah was still there. Allah still protected us. And there were people then who got scared and took a step back from their Islam. And the only protection they had was Allah, and they lost that protection. They walked away from the protection of Allah. Don't become like those people, and don't let that happen to your families. We do not have fear of people. We have fear of Allah. There's a reason we call it the fear of Allah. Because once you have that fear, nothing else scares you. Nothing else terrifies you. That's just not going to happen. Even when we stand at our death, when the angel comes to the believer and he's dying, everybody else around the believer is crying. They're afraid that this loved one is leaving this world. The angels come and say, نَحْنُ أَوْلِيَاءُكُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ. We've been your protective friends in this life and in the next life. Allah sent security guards for you from the skies. For each and every one of you, يُسِلُ عَلَيْكُمْ حَفَظًا. He sends security guards for you. That's what he says. Every time you get in the car, there's security around you from Allah. You know? So don't panic over what's happened. This is not the end of the world. And now let's take a step back. I'd like to not only give you a reminder from the book of Allah, and incidentally, in that story when the Muslims got up and said, fine, we will preempt, we will go on the offensive instead of being on the defensive. What happened? Quraysh heard that the Muslims, even though they're injured, got up. So they said, I don't think we can handle this. They ran away. They ran off. فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ لَمْ يَمْسَسْهُمْ سُوءٌ. They came back with the favor of Allah and a great additional favor, the blessings of Allah and a great additional favor. No harm touched them. When does no harm touch you? According to the formula in Surah Ali Imran. There's a formula here. No harm touches you when you grow a spine and learn to stand up for yourself. When you stop being scared. فَلَا تَخْشَوْهُمْ وَخْشَوْنِي إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Don't be afraid of them, be afraid of me if you're in fact believers. This is one third of my message to you. Who scares us? It's not actually people. Allah describes it in these ayat himself. إِنَّمَا ذَٰلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانِ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَهُ. It is no one other than shaitan, in fact. He's the one putting fear of his friends into you. Shaitan is using his friends to scare you. The other ta'wil of this ayah, awliya'ahu, another maf'ul it could be taken as, what it would mean in simple English is, the only people who get scared are friends of shaitan. So don't be a friend of shaitan and don't get scared. Don't be afraid. We have to become strong. The second thing I want to mention to you is about a simple comment about the nature of politics and its relationship with you and I as Muslims, as each individual Muslim citizen. I'd like you to understand something. Let's go into the Muslim world first. If somebody lives in Pakistan, or Malaysia, or Bangladesh, or Turkey, or somewhere else, and they have elections going on, and they have their politics, and they have their disagreements, and there are Muslims on both sides of the election. This candidate is Muslim, that candidate is Muslim. This party is Muslim, so that party is Muslim. And every Muslim in that country has a political opinion. Every one of them. But they don't all have the same opinion. They don't share the same opinion. They pray at the same time. Some of them are equally religious. They're devout to Allah. They recite the book of Allah. They pray five times a day. They pay their zakat. You know, they fulfill all of their rituals. But politically, they're completely different from each other. One has this opinion, one has that opinion. One agrees with this economic policy. The other agrees with a completely different economic policy. Why am I mentioning this to you? We have assumed that it's more Islamic to vote for one candidate than the other candidate. Or it's more Islamic to be a member of one party than the other party. Look, the Muslims are stuck. We are people, the only thing permanent for us is our principles. And when it comes to some of our principles, they're very conservative. They are. We have very conservative family values. We have very conservative religious values, social values. That's a fact of life. That is what Muslims are. When you think of conservative in America, I don't have to tell you which party you think of. On the other hand, there are certain values like civil liberties, rights, you know, protection of minorities and things like that. These are also very important to us. And that's not really associated with a certain party. It's associated with another one. And we're caught in between. Do you have to be loyal to your principles and give up on your civil liberties and, you know, take on this hateful rhetoric? Or do you hold on to this civil liberties rhetoric and rights for all? And then also agree with some of the principles that party endorses that we have nothing to do with and we will never have anything to do with. We're caught in between. Why am I mentioning this to you? Because politics and Islam are two separate things. These are two different things. Don't confuse them with each other. A lot of people that voted in this election and they voted for the winning president, they didn't vote because they hate Muslims. They have nothing. A lot of these people have nothing to do with Muslims. They've never seen a Muslim. They couldn't care less. They're just angry. They don't have jobs. Their towns have been, you know, there's been a mass migration out of their towns, and they're just mad that a democratic government for 8 years changed nothing about their economic situation. So you know what? Yeah, the guy said pretty racist things. He said some pretty hateful things. He spoke ill of the Hispanic community. He's made derogatory comments about women. So what? At least they're all corrupt anyway. So who cares about that? And maybe he'll bring some change. So for us to think it's all about they hate Muslims, this is wrong. Just like our political opinions are complicated, the people who voted in this election, the rest of our country, their political opinions are also complicated. They cannot be oversimplified as everybody hates Muslims. That would be a mistake on our part. As a matter of fact, now what I want to share with you is how are we supposed to then think about the nation that we live in? There's going to be a loud, but a very small minority of bigoted people, hateful people, that have now become very happy over this election. They feel like they're the ones that have won. And they're going to be very, very loud. They're going to put offensive bumper stickers on their cars. They're going to make comments at you when you go to the grocery store or when you're at the airport or even at the office. They're going to be there. Some of their internal spite will come out, but that is not the conscience of this nation. There are good people here. You have good neighbors. You have good teachers in your schools. You have good police officers too. There are good people in this country, and we will not, just like they, stereotype all Muslims, we're not going to do that. You will not be guilty of the same crime that you're a victim of. That you cannot allow yourself to do. So don't confuse religion and politics with each other in this way. The only thing constant in our being is principles. And on that note, I want to leave you in this khutbah with practical advice. What are we supposed to do? We, Muslims, are supposed to recognize something about the nature of politics in our country. This is our country. When you vote, for instance, or when you get involved in politics, or you endorse a candidate or not endorse a candidate, on what principle are we supposed to do so? We have an amana, wherever the Muslim lives. If you were the only Muslim living in a village, you were the only Muslim living in an island, and you were asked about picking a candidate in that island, or making a decision in that island, you wouldn't think, what's best for the ummah when I pick this candidate? You know how we think? We're going to vote because this guy's going to be good for the Muslims. We're going to vote for that one because that's going to be better for the Muslims. Or we don't even say better anymore, we say this one's going to kill the least. Right, that's how we think that. This one's going to do the least damage to the Muslims, so we'll vote for this one. This is, in my humble opinion, you are free to disagree, this is the incorrect way of thinking for any citizen. Voting or participating in any land, because you're passing your opinion, is an amanah. Whatever land you live in, whatever society you live in, you and I are responsible to think what is best for the people of this land, including myself. We are citizens. We play the role not of Muslims, but of citizens in this land that happen to be Muslims, that live by their faith. And we have to fulfill our duty. Just like at the office, if somebody asks you who should be the manager, you don't say which manager is going to be best for the Muslims in the company. No, who's the most qualified? Who's going to be best for the company? Who's going to be best for the job? Who's got the best experience? You will make these decisions based on justice and principles, not based on your bias as Muslims. Our loyalty to Islam should not taint our loyalty to justice. Justice itself. Because a candidate being chosen is supposed to be one that is good for all people. All of them, not just for ourselves. We are not another lobby group. We are not. Just because the Hispanics have a certain lobby, and there's a Hispanic voting bloc, and there's a, there's a Jewish voting bloc, and there's an Irish voting bloc, or there's a white voting bloc, there's a conservative voting bloc. People think there's a Muslim voting bloc. There isn't. There are Muslim principles. It may be that in some county, somebody recognizes that the Republican candidate is better for the community. It may happen. And they have to vote their conscience. Not, considering global politics, because they are going to go in a certain direction no matter what you do. No matter what you and I do. So my practical advice to you, that we need to now grow a spine. Many of you have jobs, you have school, you have responsibilities at home, you come to the masjid, you have a religious life, you have a spiritual life, you have responsibilities of these kind, but now we cannot afford except to be at town hall meetings in our local communities. We need to be involved and we need to show our face locally, and our kids are being bullied at schools. Muslim kids are being daily, they are being bullied at public schools. Who's going to town hall meetings and making an issue about that, about our schools? Who's raising hell saying these teachers who make these kinds of comments in our school classrooms that we pay taxes for are now discriminating against our own children off of our money? This is not acceptable. That is not something you take to the President of the United States. You take it to your local town. And when we show ourselves up, men, women, beards, hijabs, kufis, you name it, wear your thobe, I don't care. Go there. Show yourself. Then let them speak bigoted when they see you in the face. When they see you walking alone in a mall somewhere, then they can make their comments. But when you and I show up 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 strong every single week in every town that we are, we may be a minority, but we can become a very powerful minority. We can become a very powerful minority. And I would argue this is a civic responsibility we have to speak to the issues not just that pertain to Muslims, but what's better for our community? What roads need to be fixed? What schools need to be improved? What liquor stores need to be shut down that are increasing crime in the neighborhood? How are we dealing with the offenders in our neighborhood? What's happening with the arrest rates? Where's the crime rate? Who's going to hold government accountable? You know, we think when we go, many of you voted, when you went to vote for the president, and there was a ballot, we know those two top candidates, you don't know anybody else. You're like, I'll just check mark this line. This guy, this name I don't know, and this name I don't know. We don't know who people are involved in actually, you know, that are actually concerned with our local politics. And that's the one that affects your day-to-day life. That's the people that are living here in Irving, or in Euless, or some small town in Wisconsin, or in Chicago, some suburbs of Chicago. Get involved locally. You don't have to become a politician, but you have to become now an active citizen. And we have to teach our children to become active citizens. Because until we show up and grow a spine, we will remain invisible no matter how many show up for Jumu'ah. It won't matter how many are here. We have to be there. And we have to show up. You have to find this out. Educate yourselves. And become part of that society. Take some time out of your busy day and your busy lives. Because this is how we're going to build a future. We can build our homes here. We can buy cars here. We can get jobs here. But discrimination will get worse and worse and worse if we're not involved in the mainstream society. If we just keep bubbling ourselves off, we can no longer afford to do so. My final message to you, inshallah, as I close, is about Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam was supposed to stand up to Fir'aun. We don't have to. Fir'aun's much worse. I mean, maybe not that much worse, but still, much worse. And Musa alayhi salam is to go alone. And he asked Allah for support. And what support did he ask for? He asked for his brother. And what did he say about his brother? Ushdud bihi azri wa ashrikhu fi amri. Strengthen my back by means of him. You know what it means to strengthen your back? You're being pushed. You're being hit. You're falling back. And somebody's behind you to keep you from falling. That means strengthen my back. You understand? Which means Musa alayhi salam knows he's going to be on the defensive. And he needs someone to hold off the defense better because he alone will not be able to withstand the push. So he needs somebody that can push his back. And later on in Surah Al-Qasas, what did Allah say to him? سَنَشُدُّ عَضُدَكَ بِأَخِيكَ. I will strengthen your muscle, your forearm, with your brother. When do you use your forearm? When you're pushing back or when you're going forward? When you're going forward. Meaning Allah Azza wa Jalla said, I will not just give you defense, I will give you offense. I'll give you strength to speak up for, you know, and move forward. And what was the great strength of Harun alayhi salam that Musa alayhi salam recognized? What was the weapon Musa alayhi salam was going to bring? What spear, what sword? What was he going to bring? It's on the tongue of Musa himself. Huwa afsahu minni lisana. He is better spoken than I am. He speaks well. This is the age of speaking well. This is the age when our voice needs to be heard. And that is the best offense. If we remain silent, we're giving up the weapon Allah has given us. We're just giving up that weapon. This is the time to be proud as Muslims. To be confident as believers. I know I said that's the last thing. I'll take 15 more seconds, I promise. I want to share with you that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had one of the toughest lives ever lived. Those 23 years of his mission are some of the toughest in human history. There are problems in every single year. There's not a year where there's no problems. It's issue after, and there are big issues too. There are life-threatening issues. There are issues that can end the career of Islam itself. Every single year. And what do you see the Sahaba saying? We never saw him except he was smiling. You know that, right? Rasulullah ﷺ, when Sahaba came to him, all the time, they would see that he has a smile on his face. That is the consistent sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ. You tell me, when you are buried under problems, you're buried under issues, and no one has more, you and I are not under pressure. Rasulullah ﷺ, إِنَّا سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا. We're going to put a heavy word on top of you. When somebody's under a lot of pressure, the last thing you see them do is what? Smile. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam
leaves us a sunnah of being buried under pressure with all kinds of, you know, enemy forces at us, and yet there's a smile on our face. Follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be a people of alhamdulillah, be optimistic. Allah will see us through this. This is nothing. This is not an issue. It will only become a big deal for you and your family if you let it. And you, the heads of households, the men that are sitting here, you're not supposed to instill fear into your children and your spouses over what's happened. You're supposed to instill hope and confidence and strength. This is only a test from Allah, and we will come out stronger as a result. May Allah Azza wa Jalla protect this ummah and give us the ability to lead our communities the way that we were charged to lead. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us committed to our timeless principles and not sway when situations go one way or the other. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayat wa dhikr.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A few housekeeping announcements. First, sisters, there are some sisters that are trying to get in from the room behind. So if you don't want to move forward, please make space for them to be able to walk through, inshallah ta'ala, and be able to sit inside. I've noticed I can still see them. So either make it easy for them, inshallah, to come inside. Another housekeeping announcement. I forgot, I got your code, your passwords, passcodes off. But there is a, this is very important news. There's a white Nissan. Speaking of Muslims changing, right? Nissan Armada White that is blocking someone's car, and this person needs to get back to work. So this is dhulm. Move your car. Nissan White Armada. BV9J332, if anybody knows their license plate number. Nissan White Armada, inshallah ta'ala. Also, before I start, I want to recognize Sheikh Dr. Ibrahim Durmali. Barakallah fiqh. Thank you for coming to our community and being with us tonight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and reward you and increase you in ilm and ikhlas and health. Everyone say ameen. Okay, how many of you guys have not slept? All right. I personally have not slept since yesterday, so... I noticed around 4 p.m. today that I was very incoherent and I started making some basic mistakes. So if I say something that's crazy, excuse it. It's a lack of sleep. It's not, I want to share with you all something. So, Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi man wala. I know that Sheikh Yasir, inshallah, will talk about the spiritual side, more of these things. The very first thing, though, that I'll say is that always remember Allah is in control. It's one thing just trust in Allah, tawakkul ala Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will correct it, so on and so forth. Allah is always in control. And there's a lot of sakina and tranquility that comes to a person when they remind themselves that. In fact, the manifestation in dhikr of that is la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Truly, there is no power or might except that which belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Last night, I read, إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. Tonight, Sheikh Yasir read, who knows what Sheikh Yasir read in the first rak'ah? See how consumed you guys are with the elections in your salah. Barakallahu feekum. قل اللهم مالك الملك تؤتي الملك من تشاء وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. Allah honors and disgraces, Allah gives power and Allah removes power. So we do need to remind ourselves of the spiritual element, and that is something that keeps us going when things appear to be completely hopeless. Also, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من قال هلك الناس فهو أهلكهم. And in one narration, he said, فَهُوَ أَهْلَكُهُمْ, that whoever says that the people have no hope, he is the most hopeless of them all. And then أَهْلَكُهُمْ is that he is the one who's making everybody hopeless. You know what that means? The I told you so people, that, you know, you're I told you the world is ending. I told you آخر الزمان is coming. I told you. And, you know, I'll never forget a conversation. Dr. Tariq Ramadan actually said this, and it was very appealing. He said that the pessimist is usually right. So the pessimist usually has bragging rights. If you say everything's horrible and everything's terrible and you call the worst outcome of everything, then you're probably going to be right almost, you know, 70% of the time, because that's how the world works. But that doesn't mean that you're right. You're right, but you're not right at the same time, because you're doing absolutely no good for the community. and for the people when you constantly go, see, it's over. See, it's over. See, it's over. See, I told you this would happen. See, I told you this would happen. There were people in the time of Salah ad-Din that said, see, it's over. And they appeared to be right. And they probably died thinking they were right. But it wasn't over. Okay? It's not over until Israfil alayhi salam blows the trumpet. That's our modification of until the fat lady sings. Until the trumpet is blown, it's not over. We're still here, and we have to do our part, and we have to trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With that being said, there are a few things that I want to mention. Number one, be sensitive to people's emotions right now. Subhanallah, I met Dr. Suzanne Barakat, who gave her TED talk recently, whose brother, Liya, and then her sister-in-law, Yusur, and Razan, sister of Yusur, may Allah have mercy on them, all were murdered. And you have no idea what it meant when Donald Trump made that statement about some guy, this told this hoax about some guy dipping his bullets in pigs in swine blood and shooting a bunch of Muslims, and that took care of the problem. You know, you probably found that funny. Probably shared it on WhatsApp or shared it on Facebook and said, ha ha, look how crazy this man is. That deeply damaged her, right? That hurt her because she had an experience. And so I don't think we realize there's been a 500% rise in hate crimes against Muslims since the candidacy of Donald Trump, since he announced his candidacy, a 500% rise in hate crimes. People are tormented for being Muslim, right? And there are things that are happening to people because they are Muslim. And this legitimizes bigotry in a very ugly way. So we have to recognize that, and we have to be very, very, you know, considerate of people when we talk about these things. And I'll be very honest with you. Last night, I almost left about 5 or 6 WhatsApp groups, and I almost deleted a few phone numbers. It's not funny. I know there are a lot of nice, funny memes that came out last night, but trust me, Rudy Giuliani, an attorney general, wait, we'll see if we're laughing when that happens. Newt Gingrich, Michael Flynn in defense, the guy who doesn't believe that Islam is a religion. That's not very funny, right? This isn't funny. This is very, very serious stuff. And this is going to affect people's lives. People that belong to hate groups, the Center for Security Policy, Frank Gaffney, who has been likened to McCarthy, now being possibly in an actual official place, who, you know, wants to shut down practically every Muslim organization that we know, targets it, calls it a Muslim Brotherhood front, boom, we need to shut it down, on Donald Trump's foreign policy team. Brought into the political process by none other than Ted Cruz, our beloved state senator, Ted Cruz. All right? This is serious stuff. And this is disastrous, right, in that sense, right? I mean, this is very, very serious stuff. It's a test. But who's in control? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control. We did our part. I would not sit, you know, now that things have unfolded the way that they have, we trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decision. We trust that things will unfold in a way that's best for us. That doesn't mean that our efforts were in vain. They weren't in vain, because you know what? May of next year, we have a mayor election here. We're going to have to get back on our feet very, very, very quickly and continue to fight that fight. Continue to make sure that we do not allow racism against our community to be legitimized. Another thing that I want to say here. You know, Sheikh Hatim al-Hajj, who is a beloved teacher of mine, a mentor, and a very highly educated man, pediatrician and PhD in fiqh. There aren't many people that have achieved the two. A very highly qualified, educated individual. And subhanAllah, I watched him, and he doesn't have a very big Facebook page, but he wrote some things about the election. And it was interesting because he said, hey, look, I'm not an expert in this field. I know my limits. So I will trust those that are experts in this. So when people started trolling him and being very disrespectful with him, he actually said, I do taqleed in this masala. I do taqleed with these things. I follow people that know what they're talking about here. Stay in your lane. If you don't know what you're talking about, don't act like you know what you're talking about. This is a nuanced, complicated, complex issue. When people give their overly simplified versions, it is dangerous to us. It's not right. People need to know where they, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رحم الله إمران عنيم قدرته أو عرف قدرته نفسي. May Allah have mercy on a man who knows his limits. You need to know where your area is, where your limits are, what you are competent enough to comment on. No offense. No offense, honestly. What you should be commenting on and what you should not be commenting on. I'm not going to comment on medicine and go toe-to-toe with any doctor in here. Or the 80% of you that work in tech. I'm not going to comment with you. I'm not going to go toe-to-toe with you on tech. That's your forte. It's not my forte. I know my limits. I know that that's not my space to comment in. So number one, humility, intellectual humility. Well, I was watching Dr. Hadam. I said, subhanAllah, what a beautiful man. If there is anyone that could claim that I can comment on any issue, it's him. From just a pure education perspective. But he said, you know, this isn't my area, so I'm going, you know, I'm trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm doing my best, and I'm asking people I trust that know these areas. Overly simplistic portrayals of these things do more harm than good. All right? Lastly here, what I really want to talk about, and this is something that I think is very, very important for us to adapt as a community. Please go back and watch that video with Dr. Michael Waters here. Please go back. If there's anything you want to do that's good for yourself, honestly, in terms of just understanding where we are right now as a nation, go back. Can we repost that on the Valley Ranch page, inshallah ta'ala? Go back and watch that video when he came. SubhanAllah is reflecting on a lot of what was said that evening. What other communities have been through here. Time is on our side. You want to know how we know time is on our side? Do you know that if you were to take the vote, the 18 to 25 vote only, meaning everyone that voted in this election under 25, you know what the electoral count would have been? Hillary Clinton would have had 535 electoral votes. You know why? Because people under 25 voted white, black, Latino, everything. They voted in rejection of Donald Trump for that reason. That's encouraging. Time is on our side. The generation that's coming up in this country is far more tolerant, right? This was a dying breed of white supremacy that manifested itself along with economic frustration, going with an anti-establishment candidate as filthy as he is, an anti-establishment candidate against the representation of establishment, bankrupt, big government politics. Mix it all up, it's a disaster. Young people didn't fall for that. Young people did not fall for that. That's encouraging. Time's on our side. We got to ride it out. Yeah, it's going to be tough for a few years, but you know what? As tough as it may be, it is still way easier than it is in many parts of the world. Still one of the easiest situations to be living in as Muslims. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not testing us the way he's testing other Muslims. Alhamdulillah, we're not being tested for our faith the way other Muslims are being tested with, even in very developed countries. Even in, you know, in Europe and different in very developed countries, Muslims are being tested a lot more severely. Now, can it get that way? Sure, it could. But we, you know, we have husn al-dhan in Allah. We'll do our part and we'll see what happens. But we are, even with an incoming neocon, you know, across the board red government, we are not being tested the way other Muslims are being tested. And time is on our side. So we need to ride this out. We need to be smart about how we institutionalize. We need to finally learn the lesson that respectability politics don't work. You could parade Muslim military men all over the world that you want and say, we're just as American as you. It doesn't work. It's like one person, you know, from the black community, a civil rights, actually it was Dr. Cornel West. He said that respectability politics is like living your life like a job interview and getting rejected every single day of your life. So as a Muslim community, if we keep on going down that route with a job interview and saying, accept us, accept us, accept us. Look, we're just as American as you. It doesn't work because bigotry is not rational. Bigotry is not rational. Racism is not rational. The reason why legislation has been passed in this country that was favorable to the African American community is not because white people suddenly felt bad and said, you know, maybe we should let them vote. You know, maybe we should you know, it's not like LBJ, who the 635 has been named after, which made me have very negative feelings towards Lyndon B. Johnson just because I hated the 635. It's not like he said, you know what, this is the right thing to do for the black community. Let's go ahead and pass this bill. It's called pressure. Okay? If you listen to Malcolm X, rahimahullah ta'ala, what did Malcolm X say? Malcolm X said, the greatest obstacle we have are black leaders that are still trying to play that game, that are still trying to play that respectability game. Racism is not rational. Bigotry is not rational. Okay, if you meet a racist and they're impressed by you, then they might just say, well, maybe you're not like the rest of the Muslims. But it's not like, by and large, racists will say, oh, you know, Muslims are great people. Pressure. We need to stand up for our rights, demand the rights of our community and the rights of other communities as well. So far, the way that we've done it, and you know, Dr. Martin Luther King said the same thing. He said that his greatest obstacle, what he was growing most frustrated with, were moderate whites that would say, I agree with his protest, I don't agree with his method. That were more committed to order than justice. Think about that. When Colin Kaepernick took a knee for the national anthem, what did a lot of people say? We agree with you, the issue is right, but no, that's, how could you do such a thing? We agree with your protest, we don't agree with your method. All right, that basically means don't shake it up. Okay? Don't shake it up. All right? Don't do anything that's going to demand change. Don't do anything that will get the attention. So you know what? We need to abandon that type of thinking as a community, and we need to ally ourselves with people that have been through this vicious cycle that we've now been a part of ourselves. What that means is that when we sit here and we demand an end to Islamophobia, we're not just demanding an end to Islamophobia. Do you know what the black community has been through in this country? Go back and watch that video with Dr. Michael Waters. And we can sit here and think, hey, why are they whining so much? And maybe it's not that big of a deal. Last year, 1,087 people were killed by the police. That's the most in history. That's the most in history. That's a problem. Police brutality is an issue. So if we're gonna condemn police shootings, which we should, we need to condemn police brutality, and we need to not be shy about it as a community. Mass incarceration in this country. This country has more prisoners in the history of the world in a privatized prison industry. Think about that. More prisoners than any country in the world. Think about other countries in the world that have high crime rates. More prisoners than any country in the world, our country. More prisoners than any country in the history of the world, our country. It's a problem. It needs reform. So when you're talking about partnering with particularly the black community, the African American community, and demanding dignity for people that have been the targets of this vicious cycle over and over and over again, which we're just bearing a little pinch of. We haven't been through anything that they've been through. Voter intimidation, we haven't been through anything. Right, so fighting for issues as well with the Latino community. Where are Muslims on those issues, on immigration? Mexicans were called rapists by our new president. It just sounds so bad. It's hard to eat. Wallahi, I don't know how. I don't think I'll ever be able to say it. All right? Did we do any outreach to the Latino community? Have we met anyone from the Latino? Have we spoken to that issue as well? Have we spoken to that issue as well? I hold myself accountable, right? All of us need to really, really think deeply about where we fall in the spectrum. So please analyze things carefully. At the same time, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. It's very easy for people to comment on how things should be. If you're doing nothing about it, then reserve your comments to yourself. Okay? Be part of the solution, or else you are part of the problem. And at the same time, dear brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, we will make it through this. Time is on our side. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control. If we struggle a little bit, I remember giving a khutbah a few months ago about the problem with being too comfortable. When we're too comfortable, we get too complacent. When we're not comfortable, inshallah ta'ala, we mobilize a little bit better. Inshallah ta'ala, we need to make sure that we continue to build our pathway, inshallah, and be principled, do our part, inshallah ta'ala, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place us on the side of the truth wherever it is, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not allow us to go astray. I want to share with you all one message as well. On Sunday, I actually spoke at the oldest church in Dallas. Amazing, amazing looking church. which is First United Methodist on Ross Avenue. And just as I was sitting here, actually, Salatul Isha, the pastor, Dr. Andy Stoker, sent this message, and he said, "Omar, I'm here for you. I believe in your work, and I believe in you. We are better together than apart. If there's anything I can do to be a conversation partner for you or your community, I'm here for you. I'm praying for you and your community." There are, you know, we have to remember not to this is, the Prophet ﷺ said, don't lose hope in the people. Was he talking about the Muslims? No. Don't lose hope in the people. Don't lose hope in the people. Young people in this country, inshallah ta'ala, are far more tolerant, and that will pose its own set of challenges, by the way, right? But hopefully racism is not one of them. Okay, that's not their mojo. That's not what they're about. Okay, and at the same time, there are a lot of good people that are ashamed right now of where we are as a country. They are ashamed. They are so ashamed that they're sending in messages that we're hearing from them, and you know, we need to, inshallah ta'ala, partner with people that are like-minded and try our best to do better and ask Allah for His guidance the entire time. Many times. And I'll hand it over to Sheikh Yasser with this. We think we're doing good, but we're actually doing bad. قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالَ الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions losers who think they're doing good, but they're actually doing bad. So we ask Allah to preserve us in goodness, to put us on the path of truth, to grant us sincerity, to allow us, inshallah ta'ala, to be people that stand for the mazloom, the way the Prophet ﷺ was described by Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, to allow us to be a people that remain firm on our religion no matter how we are tested, no matter how severely we are tested, to not test us beyond our scope, to allow us to pass through this phase with steadfastness, and to allow the good to come out of it to be better than the bad that we anticipated before. Allahumma ameen. Inshallah, I'll pass it to Sheikh Yasser, and then I guess we'll have some Q&A, inshallah. Just one thing to the youth in here, by the way, and this is something that Fuad just reminded me we should speak to. You know, today actually, when I was talking to my daughter May, everyone was talking about the conversation they were going to have with their kid. So, you know, when I was talking to May, and anyone who knows May, so her conversation is very, she doesn't stop at one answer. SubhanAllah, we're talking about a bully. We don't teach our children and we don't teach people to back down from bullies, and that we accept bullying and we tolerate it. We stand up strong and we stand up to bullies, and we continue to walk proudly, inshallah ta'ala. This is a chance to really claim our identity and to really stand strong and to keep yourself firm, especially to our sisters, inshallah ta'ala. You know, every time you go out there and you are in your hijab, you are mujahida fi sabilillah. I'm using that word. You're striving in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, by you are literally, you know, showing resistance by being out there. And our salah in public, our continuing to identify as Muslims as public, not running away from whatever it is our obligations are in public. This is our struggle, inshallah ta'ala, as well. And it's a form of resistance in and of itself, to not only be Muslim but to be proud of being Muslim, and to be unafraid to challenge the country, and to challenge, you know, to challenge the injustices that we see around us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us and to keep us firm, inshallah ta'ala, on those things. All right, questions? I didn't see which one came up, Sheikh. I think it was Majd first, actually. Majd, yeah. Thank you. you want to answer? So subhanAllah, that's a very good, the question is, you know, so on one hand, we should speak about things that are important, the issues, and offer an Islamic framework to people's issues. And inshallah ta'ala, that's something that I hope our masjid, you know, under the leadership of Sheikh Yasser and what we're doing here, inshallah ta'ala, I hope that we're trying to be open and discuss things in an open fashion, inshallah ta'ala, and help people through some of these things. Then on the other hand, you know, we're saying, you know, you shouldn't speak about that which you don't know. I didn't say that. So what I meant by that is, don't act like an expert when you're not an expert. Okay? Now, it's not like if the Prophet ﷺ, you know, saw, or if a companion sees something that's wrong, he sees someone's money being taken away, someone having his money taken away from him. You know, it's not like, okay, I need to take a step back and I need to evaluate all the factors which led to the man stealing money from you, because maybe he had a right to steal your money. Maybe there's something else I don't know. No. All right? It's a very clear wrongdoing that's in front of me, so I should say something about it. مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرْ فَلْيُغَيِّرُهُ بِيَدِهِ. Whoever amongst you sees evil, let him change it with his hand. If he can't do so, then with his tongue. And if he can't do so, then he should hate it with his heart. And that's the lowest of iman. Now, you should always know your limits, though, when you're talking about an issue. You should know your limits when you are talking about an issue and not transgress. This is true even in da'wah. It's the balance, and it's not a mathematical equation, okay? You do da'wah with things that you know of. You speak about issues that you are, that you know, the things that you're confident about. When you're asked a question that you don't know, have the humility to say, you know, I don't know, let me get back to you. Let me talk to someone who's more knowledgeable than me, or let me connect you with someone that's more knowledgeable than me. So people need to know their limits, and that's what the Prophet ﷺ mentions. You know your limits. So issues are important. Now, I'm going to say this, that at every level, people have to be responsible and people have to watch themselves and hold themselves accountable. What that means is, you know, may Allah protect us, people that have followings. May Allah protect us. I want you guys to say Ameen. Because we can easily get caught up with ourselves and give too much weight to our own opinions. And people will believe utter nonsense that comes out of our mouths just because we have a public platform. It's true in the Christian community, right? Preachers, self-serving preachers that can take advantage of adoring followers and say whatever they want to say that's not consistent with any form of legitimate Christianity whatsoever, they could butcher it and get away with it. But Allah will hold them accountable. And that's why it's very, very, very important for people to have mechanisms to protect themselves. All right? Number one, your own internal mechanism is your spirituality. Why am I saying this? Why am I speaking about it? Is it for some self-fulfillment? Is it for my ego or is it for my ikhlas? Is it because I really want to call to Allah, or do I want to call to myself? Do I want to impress somebody? So the internal spiritual check. Why am I going to speak? Number two, when I speak, there's a certain level of knowledge that I should have when I speak on this issue. So I need to make sure that I'm speaking about an issue that's within my domain. Number three, the people check. The people check is that I need to have someone more knowledgeable than me when I'm speaking on something that's going to require that. So the mentorship check, the sheikh check, if I'm in the domain of religious terminology. And then shura. Peer review. You know, in academia, you write a journal, it's peer reviewed. All right? We need to have peer review when we speak about issues. Shura. We need to consult people and be willing to listen to people that tell us things that are not necessarily in line with what we think is right, but we need to hear people out. All right? Listen to your honest critics, people that will tell you that, hey, I think you went too far there, or I think you went too far here, because otherwise you're just going to keep on speaking and speaking and speaking, and you're not keeping yourself in check. So that's true for everyone, from a sheikh to a person who just goes to work and meets people and things of that sort, you know, to keep those mechanisms there. And of course, always renewal of your intention. Always renewal of your intention. And I'll tell you guys this. It doesn't take a sheikh to serve the homeless. Like, you don't have to have ilm to serve homeless people. Right? You don't have to have ilm to stand up for the mazloom. You don't have to have ilm to recognize that there is something grossly wrong about certain things around you. That doesn't require you to be a scholar or a PhD. And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said something very, very powerful. He said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the best message. The best message. He had an Islamic framework to everyone's problems. But if people did not trust that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was acting in their favor because he had been acting in their favor for a prolonged period of time, then even the best message would have fell on deaf ears. But they knew that he cared for them because he was there for them and he worked on their, you know, on their behalf and he was in their favor. So being in the service of people allows you to have some sort of credibility when you say something. Otherwise, if you're going to speak from afar and say, hey guys, all of you that are complaining and everyone that's messed up, I have a solution. It's Islam. It's like, who are you? Where did you come from again? Are you from that masjid that looks like a fortress? You know, that we never see any khair come out of? All right, who are you? What's your... So alhamdulillah, I know, mashallah, you've been a part of some of those projects. So may Allah bless you. So you know I'm not talking at you. I'm talking for all of us, right? But inshallah ta'ala, just know your limits. Always seek shura. Always try to refine your opinion. And always have the intellectual humility. You know, the genius of our imams is Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala. The man was a genius. By the full definition of the word genius, right? There's no imam, probably in the history of the deen, that was recognized as a genius at that young of an age, right? He was a genius. But even he said that, I'm right with the possibility that I might be wrong. I fully acknowledge I might be wrong. And, you know, when I say something, when I've went through all the checks and, you know, that I need to say something, I still acknowledge I might be wrong on this issue. So always have that intellectual humility.
Okay.
So a lot of times, subhanAllah, in my own experience, and I know Sheikh Yasir will feel the same about this. If you don't, then please stop me. We have let Muslims that are not authentic representations of the community represent us in these spaces because we're afraid we'll be too uncomfortable. And that has had disastrous results for us in public policy, in interfaith, in everything, you name it. Okay? So we simply cannot afford to not be at these tables and to not be at these places. And we assert ourselves within our full principles. Right? And yes, there will be a lot of awkwardness in the beginning of these things. Right? I can tell you, it is very awkward for me in many, 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 many of these city meetings. As co-chair right now, Faith Forward Dallas, alhamdulillah, which I'm enjoying quite a bit, there are some extremely awkward moments. All right? But, you know, if we're not there, who's going to be there? So I tell the community, I understand that it's uncomfortable, but if we continue to let people that are not true representatives of us represent us in these spaces, then it's going to be really awkward in 20 years and even more awkward in 40 years, right? So we have to represent ourselves in these spaces, inshallah ta'ala. So may Allah reward you for being a part of those things. Yeah, and the I Have a Plan piece of this masjid is for that purpose, to open the door to everyone that wants to be a part of something and find your role, inshallah ta'ala, and be a part of something, inshallah. When's our next one? Do we have our next one yet? We got to have our next one. So inshallah, you follow up and we'll find it, inshallah. Yeah, last question from each side. I think we should go this way. We'll go two and then one maybe, Sheikh, three? Yeah. One, two, and then one of the sisters. Yeah.
Light also, it's a lot less scary, it's a lot less them and us.
Now, Jazakallah khair. Just to speak to your, yeah, we should not generalize. However, there is an ugly closet racism. A lot of people were closet Trump supporters for the racism. And even with genuine economic genuine economic grievances, the fact that all of that did not disqualify him from being a viable candidate, you know? So even if I myself am not a racist, but I still found it okay to vote for a racist for legitimate grievances is a problem. However, I agree with you. We should... Again, this was an anti-establishment, in many ways an anti-establishment vote from many, many, many people. And the second point about Hillary, I had, subhanAllah, I thought, like many people, that we were going to wake up and we were going to see a Hillary Clinton, you know, president-elect, like we all expected, like all the prediction industry, you know, the Nate Silvers of the world, who have become like the horoscopes that are haram right now at this point. You know, it's like people really believe in that stuff, you know, and clearly... Nate Silver failed us, and all of those in the prediction industry failed us. But I had this whole thing in mind, like as soon as she was voted in, I was like, all right, can we stop pretending like she's been a friend of the Muslim community now? Can we stop pretending like we like her? Can we stop pretending like she didn't say that the Palestinian election should be rigged? She had a lot of issues. So this was not a pro-Hillary thing at all. The fact that an openly racist candidate campaigned on targeting the Muslim community and people found it acceptable to vote for him tells you a lot about where we're at as a country, though. But Jazakallah khair, your comments are very well taken, not to generalize people, and we should talk to everybody, inshallah. One sister, one brother. Yeah. You know, subhanAllah, I wanted to just, with this one thing, and it really, really, the idea that things go up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, when you talk about the irony of all ironies, last night, Donald Trump, the hotel... Where the victory speech was hosted. Does anyone know that's a historical hotel? Does anyone know anything about it? That is the place where Malcolm X, rahimahullah, spent his last night. SubhanAllah, the irony of it, right? It shows you things go up, things go down, but you know, at the same time, we know that these people did not die in vain, that inshallah ta'ala they started something. And inshallah ta'ala, goodness comes out of that. So sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes down. Inna ma'al usri yusra. With hardship comes ease. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us yusra after this usra, to grant us some ease after hardship. And I'm going to hand it over to Sheikh Yasser to close us out, inshallah. Dua.